Many people, when you looked at the title, might have thought that I was going to talk about vaccine refusals, and I'm not going to talk about that. So, but before everybody run out of the room, I just want to let you know, the reason I'm not is that Paul Offit was here talking a little bit about vaccine refusals about a year ago, and then we've had a couple other talks, including a very good one by Barbara Mashiki that included HPV vaccination and vaccine refusals. So I changed my grand rounds. This is going to be a bit of a new grand rounds. If it just tanks, let me know, and I'll change it again next time. I have no disclosures, and I'm going to start with a case, but this is a different kind of case. So usually it's a subject, you know, like a patient, and this time the case is you. Imagine that you have leadership in a primary care practice, and you want to practice population medicine. So you ask the following questions. How well can we prevent diseases with vaccines now, and how well will we prevent them in the future? What are the vaccination rates in my practice, or in the country for that matter, and how can we optimize our vaccination rates? So I'm going to talk about the current status of child and adolescent vaccination delivery and some remaining challenges. There are a lot of challenges, but I'll just cover three. Preparing for new vaccines or new guidelines, evaluating the impact of new vaccines or guidelines, and then interventions to try to raise rates. So just a little bit of a background. We've had dramatic declines in vaccine-preventable diseases compared to the pre-vaccine era. This slide shows the unbelievable reduction in all of those diseases that you can see on the left-hand side. Although sometimes there's outbreaks. Remember the outbreak of measles a couple years ago? Although just yesterday I heard that the World Health Organization declared the Americas measles free again. The reason we've had such reduction in vaccine-preventable diseases is that vaccine-specific coverage among children is very high. So you could see the percent vaccinated. The most recent data that we have for the country is 2014. And vaccination rates in general are incredibly high given the complexity of the vaccine schedule and everything. Not for every vaccine. So for young children, rotavirus and two hepatitis A doses, the vaccination rates are still suboptimal. This is really a credit to the primary care community, pediatrics and family medicine. This is the complicated immunization schedule. It feels like we're giving a ton of vaccines every single visit. I can't even keep the vaccine schedule straight, so I just always ask Carlos or somebody else. Here's just some new recent vaccines that we're, that we're starting to give now, and this includes rotavirus vaccine, pertussis, hepatitis A, some new guidelines, HPV, and meningococcal vaccine. And so all of this complexity, new vaccines, does give some current challenges. Before a vaccine, how do you prepare for new vaccines? How does research feed into that? After vaccines are in the market, how do you assess the status of vaccination delivery? And then if the rates are low, what do you do about it? So let's start talking about before vaccine. And I'm going to give you a simplified diagram of the sort of the steps in vaccine policy and research in this country. How are new vaccine guidelines developed? And this is the old way, decades ago. So, and I'm not minimizing this because this is really, really important. So there was basic and preclinical studies on vaccine development, really great studies. Vaccine manufacturers then developed potential vaccines. They launched phase one, phase two, phase three clinical trials, which led to licensure. And then ACIP recommended the vaccines, harmonized the recommendations with AAP, AAFP, and other bodies. And then there were studies of vaccine coverage. So the new model for vaccination guidelines adds some new pieces to this scheme. The first is that there have been many CDC-funded and other really good studies of the disease burden to demonstrate whether is the burden large enough to warrant a new vaccine or a new guideline. A second is that there's cost studies and delivery studies that feed into ACIP recommendations. And then there are studies of the vaccine effectiveness and reduction in disease burden. So you need more than just phase one through three clinical trials. What about in the real world? Does the vaccine work? And then if vaccination rates are low, we need studies for barriers and interventions to improve rates. So I think this new model has really helped the process of national guidelines. And I'm going to talk about three of these boxes. Not to minimize the others, I just want to talk about three today. So let me tell you about the new vaccine surveillance network. And this talks about, and this is going to focus on the pre-vaccine research. So I've been very involved with this network nationally since the late 1990s. This is a really cool network. The purpose is to study the disease burden before a new vaccine or before a new guideline, and also to study vaccine effectiveness after a new vaccine comes on the market. We focus on acute respiratory illnesses, or ARIs, and acute gastroenteritis, or AGEs. There's a separate type of network like this for sexually transmitted diseases, for HPV and other things. The methods are very simple. This is really simple. We do active prospective surveillance, so we place people in the hospital, in EDs, in the outpatient. We do parent interviews. We enroll all kids or a systematic sample of kids who have acute respiratory illnesses or acute gastroenteritis. We get nasopharyngeal swab stool samples, do sophisticated laboratory analysis using PCR and multiplex methods. And we go back and measure vaccination rates from charts in order to assess vaccine effectiveness. And this is just a pictorial about the new the NVSN sites. I'm still very involved with the Rochester site. The three stars are the original NVSN sites. And I'm going to show you some examples about how the studies from this surveillance network has led to vaccine policy. So ACIP recommendations for flu vaccine. For those of you who were around before 2004, you may remember that the people who were recommended to get the influenza vaccination were elderly and adults and children if they were high risk for complications from flu vaccine. And that covered about 2 to 4 million children. And in 2004, ACIP increased the recommendations to cover all children 6 months to 23 months of age, which added another 6 million kids to be vaccinated. And then around 2003, 2004, there was a big debate about whether to extend the flu vaccine recommendations to all kids less than 5, or maybe even universally. And one of the big debates was, is the burden of disease large enough to warrant it? People follow me? All right, so then we did a study. This is led by Kathy Paling from Vanderbilt about the burden of influenza disease. This was, again, prospective surveillance for acute respiratory illnesses, just the way I talked about, in the hospital, EDs, and clinics. We enrolled several thousand inpatients who had respiratory disease. We didn't know what it was yet, but then we did viral cultures and PCR to look for whether they had flu, and if not flu, we also looked at other viruses. And we did the same thing in the ED and the outpatient clinics. And here's some of the important findings. This shows the rates per 1,000 children. So because this is surveillance within hospitals, EDs, clinics, that is representative of a geographic area, we can actually figure out population-wide rates. So out of 1,000 kids who live in a certain region, how many kids will be hospitalized or seen in an ED or seen in a clinic? And about 1 in 1,000 are hospitalized, or were back then. 27 in 1,000 were seen in an ED, and 95 in 1,000, or almost 1 in 10 kids were seen in a clinic for flu. So there's a relatively large burden of hospitalizations due to influenza, a very large burden of ED visits and clinic visits. And the other interesting finding is that back then, very few, only a minority, about 20% of these hospitalizations, ED visits, or clinic visits were actually recognized as being due to influenza. They were bronchiolitis, other sort of other things, but we didn't know that it was influenza. And I've shown here kind of a pyramid pictorial about the burden of influenza in terms of number of cases. We've been doing these studies every couple of years, and you can sort of see the studies on the left-hand side. So there's few hospitalizations, more ED visits, and more outpatient clinic visits. And we've also done cost studies. So even though there's few hospitalizations are expensive. So this is the distribution on your right-hand side about sort of the burden of costs. And these are direct medical costs and also indirect costs, like time lost from work or lost from school. And you can see that all three, hospitalizations, ED visits, outpatient visits, contribute a lot. So going back to 2004, these data, and then data from other studies for sure, led to an expansion of the recommendations to vaccinate all kids less than 59 months of age, or less than 60 months of age, which added another 10 million kids to be vaccinated. Similar studies were done in the following years, and then the universal flu vaccination recommendations came into being. So you may ask, if you're running a practice, well, how well does the flu vaccine work? So they do phase one, phase two, phase three trials, but what about in the real world? A postdoc of mine, Kate Eisenberg, this brilliant person, came up with a very simple method to measure vaccine effectiveness using NVSN data. So this was still the NVSN studies, prospective surveillance, and cases and controls were kids who came in, were hospitalized, seen in the ED or the clinic for respiratory illnesses. Cases were flu positives, controls were flu negatives. They actually sort of looked similar. We measured vaccination status by doing chart reviews. And then for those people who are interested, you can actually calculate influenza vaccine effectiveness using that equation there. So this is not efficacy, this is effectiveness in the real world. And here's what we found. Sort of good news and not the best news in the world. This slide shows influenza vaccine effectiveness among fully vaccinated kids for 2 years. 1 year, the vaccine effectiveness was pretty low for 6 to 23-month-old. The next year, it was a little bit higher. For older kids, it was a little bit better. Now, this isn't totally surprising because the flu vaccine is a complicated vaccine, and I'm not gonna go into details, except there are people like Jim Cherry who try to match the flu vaccine for the next season to the types of influenza that's going to be hitting the world and the United States in the next season. It's kind of a chess game. It's really complicated to do, so it's not surprising that the flu vaccine isn't always super effective. But what we found is that influenza vaccine effectiveness varied by age. It was better for older kids. It varied by seasons. It was moderate overall. This is not the most effective vaccine overall. And we also found, based on these kind of studies, that it's really important to measure vaccine effectiveness every year. You just can't rest with influenza. Our network, and then also a very important network of the Flu VE network and other studies, have been measuring vaccine effectiveness every year. And here's an example of why it's important. I don't know if probably everybody has heard that just in June, ACIP ruled to no longer recommend live attenuated influenza vaccine. And the reason is that these vaccine effectiveness annual studies showed that for 3 years in a row, LAIV was not effective, while the injectable vaccine was effective. And actually, I don't know why LAIV was not effective. People are really still investigating that. But I'm just trying to point out the importance of measuring vaccine effectiveness regularly. So you say, okay, we're preventing many cases of flu, even though the vaccine isn't perfect. I'm still seeing a ton of acute respiratory illnesses, right? What other respiratory illnesses might we prevent in the future? So I have one slide showing this. This slide shows the burden of several diseases: RSV, parainfluenza, influenza, and human metapneumovirus. The y-axis is the rate per 1,000 kids who live in the area. So this is truly population-based. I just showed you, remember that pyramid for the flu vaccine? And actually that pyramid is shrinking now overall, because we're measuring this every year. It's shrinking because the flu vaccination rates have risen some, although we'll talk about that. And so Karen Hall from Rochester led a series of studies actually to demonstrate the large burden of RSV disease. And the green again is office visits, blue is ED visits, and red is hospitalizations. Jeff Weinberg from Rochester led some studies to show a pretty large burden of parainfluenza disease. We looked at influenza, and remember John Edwards was here talking a few months ago about human metapneumovirus infections and demonstrated that actually the burden of human metapneumovirus infections is about the same now as the burden of flu disease. This is important because it turns out vaccines are in the pipeline for RSV, parainfluenza, and human metapneumovirus. I'm kind of expecting that in a couple of years, ACIP will be assessing RSV vaccination for pregnant women to prevent disease among infants. So back to the case. So you say, well, we see a lot of acute gastrointestinal disease as well as ARIs. What about preventing acute gastrointestinal disease? So just a brief run through for rotavirus. And this is sort of the same scheme. We looked at, with Dan Payne leading the study, the burden of rotavirus disease before the vaccine was licensed. And NVSN did surveillance for acute gastrointestinal disease in 2006, same method that we did for acute respiratory illness, but this is for gastrointestinal disease. And we found two important results. The first is that the proportion of gastrointestinal disease in the inpatient and the emergency department that was due to rotavirus was pretty astounding. Half of all hospitalizations for diarrhea and gastroenteritis were due to rotavirus. And same thing for the ED visits. And about a quarter of all gastrointestinal disease in the outpatient clinics were due to rotavirus before the vaccine. And the population-wide burden of rotavirus is depicted in this slide. One in 150 children were hospitalized for rotavirus, and one in 11 kids were seen in either the ED or outpatient clinics for rotavirus disease. And in 2006, ACIP recommended rotavirus vaccination, and the uptake was relatively rapid initially. This slide again shows vaccination coverage. It hasn't been as high as many of us wanted. It's sort of peaking at 75%, 70-75%. But there's some good news about this. This is actually more effective vaccine than we can so far influenza vaccine is. We've been doing annual studies about rotavirus vaccine effectiveness, and it's about 80% effective year after year after year, which is great news. And this slide shows the proportion of childhood acute gastrointestinal hospitalizations who are testing rotavirus positive. So remember I said half of all hospitalizations for diarrhea and gastroenteritis were due to rotavirus before the vaccine. You can see that on the left-hand side. And it's really plummeted over the years after the rotavirus vaccine was recommended and uptake vaccination rates rose. In case people are wondering why you get this every other year bump, I have no idea, so ask the ID people. This is the state of the way it works for rotavirus. You know, the bad news from my point of view is that we're still having a decent amount of remaining disease burden, which is why we need to raise rates even higher. So you might say, we're reducing rotavirus disease. What about other diarrheal disease? Now I'm just gonna spend 1 or 2 minutes on norovirus, which as a generalist, I used to think was a cruise ship disease. Or you heard about the Chipotle outbreak or outbreaks. It turns out that norovirus is far more common and far greater burden than many of us used to think. I didn't actually show rotavirus data on this, and I'm just gonna show sort of one slide for norovirus. We're doing the same level of surveillance, and there's a lot of norovirus hospitalizations out there, particularly in kids less than a year of age, or about 1 to 2 years of age. This just shows 2 years worth of norovirus burden, and we've been doing this every year since about 2008. Since the introduction of the rotavirus vaccine, norovirus has now become the leading cause of medically attended acute gastroenteritis in the US. It causes 14,000 hospitalizations, 280,000 ED visits, 620,000 outpatient visits. And this is important for norovirus vaccine policy because norovirus vaccines are being developed and several are now in phase 2 trials. All of the vaccine candidates have the G1, G2 genotypes, which happen to cause the majority of the disease burden. And I'm kind of expecting that in about 5 years, there will be a norovirus vaccine and you primary care physicians will be able to start preventing norovirus. So that was this part of the schema. And I just wanna go spend a minute about ACIP because this appears to be sort of a black box about how they make guidelines and recommendations. And I'm just gonna have 1 or 2 slides about this. This shows the key elements for developing recommendations for either a new vaccine or a change in the vaccine guidelines. And currently, I think this is actually really, really good. And I'm just starting to learn about this on ACIP. They very systematically, with a very large group of people feeding information into ACIP, look at vaccine safety, vaccine efficacy, which is defined as the efficacy before it's going out into the real world. These are phase 3 trials. Vaccine effectiveness, the burden of disease, which is just what I spent the last 15 minutes talking about, and an economic analysis about the benefits and costs. They create evidence tables. They add in implementation issues, although they can't grade them the way they do systematic grading, and then come up with a recommendation. It is a sort of a group human effort, but it's a really very thoughtful process in this country. So how do we even know what vaccine coverage is? And I just, in case people don't know, I wanted to introduce to you the National Immunization Surveys, because this is a really neat thing that's done in this country. Every year, this country measures immunization rates for young children, and every several years they measure immunization rates for adolescents. This is done at the state, for every single state, with a large enough sample size for all states and some of the largest cities. They do a random digit dial, very sophisticated random sampling of people, do chart reviews for any place that they had gone to for medical visits to measure immunization rates. And that's how they sort of roll up immunization rates by state and for the entire US. And those, that's how I got the graphs that I showed you before. And the other, the neat thing is, I love this statement, if you don't measure something, how do you know if you're doing it well, if you don't measure it? And so this is one aspect of primary care that we measure very well, at least on a national level, and it identifies vaccines with low coverage. So I'm going to turn my talk, sort of change it a little bit, and talk about vaccines with low coverage. And I want to focus on two vaccines, HPV vaccine and flu vaccine. So we talked a little bit about influenza. Let me just first talk about a little bit about HPV and then back to influenza, and then we'll talk about methods to raise vaccination rates. So HPV, Barbara gave a wonderful talk, so I'm just going to blow through this as an introduction. That's what HPV looks like. I actually have an HPV tie, although I forgot to wear it today. So if people want to know what an HPV looks like, I'll wear the tie next time. It's the most common sexually transmitted infection. It's not gonorrhea or chlamydia, it's HPV. More than 50% of men and women will be infected at some point in their lives. That translates to 79 million Americans currently infected, 14 million new infections a year, 38,000 new infections across the country per day. And it's most common, the virus is most commonly, people are infected in their teens and early 20s. Pretty astounding. The reason this is important is because of cancer. And this slide shows the percentage of different types of cancers that are attributable to HPV virus. 95% of cervical cancers, half of vaginal, vulvar, penile, anal, and 70% of anal cancers, and up to 70% of oropharyngeal cancers are due to HPV virus. And if trends continue, the annual number of HPV-positive oropharyngeal cancers will surpass the number of cervical cancers within a few years. This pyramid, I don't know why I'm into pyramids today, but this pyramid shows the number of cancers and genital warts attributable to HPV infections, 340,000 genital warts per year and 26,000 cancers per year, a huge public health burden. The great news is that there's HPV vaccines, there's three vaccines licensed in the US, actually two of them are gonna drop off the market within a year from what I hear. They all contain HPV 16 and 18, which are the most oncogenic types of HPV. Phase three trials have shown very high vaccine efficacy, high safety, the immunity lasts for a long time. It's recommended for 11 to 26 year olds. So what's the problem? Well, the problem is this. This is now vaccination coverage among adolescents in the United States. So this slide to me is like good news and bad news. The good news is that for pertussis vaccine and meningococcal vaccine, coverage is really high. So we're doing very well. But for HPV vaccine, coverage is low. And can you see that it's not in girls, it's not rising very much. And in boys, it's really low, rising because it's so darn low. But there's a big problem here. Among girls, rates are low and rising slowly. Among boys, they're extremely low, although they're rising. I'm going to flip to influenza virus and then sort of swing back and talk about what can we do about this. So we talked about the burden of influenza disease, and we talked about the fact that the vaccine is not perfect, but it's moderately effective. Well, here's a problem. The vaccination rates are suboptimal. We just can't seem to bump this much higher than these numbers. Among preschool kids, around 67 to 74% of kids are vaccinated. And among school-age kids, only about half of kids are vaccinated. And those people who are in primary care, you know this, because we just can't seem to get a lot of, you know, all the kids vaccinated. And rates have plateaued. And influenza disease burden remains higher than it should be. So if you're running your practice and you're trying to practice population-based medicine, you may say, well, why are HPV and flu vaccination rates low? And what can I do about it in my practice? What could we do about it across the country? So I'm going to just sort of move over to studies of barriers and interventions to improve rates. Okay. And what we'll do is we'll take a trip back in time to the 1980s. That was kind of silly. But anyway, we'll take a trip back in time to the 1980s when, Jim remembers this so well, there was a big measles epidemic with 55,000 cases, 11,000 hospitalizations, 130 deaths. And the CDC funded a number of studies, including one in LA, actually, one in Rochester, which I led, and other studies across the country, to figure out why are vaccination rates low. At the time, in the 1980s, it was sort of the mantra was vaccination rates are low because parents don't want their kids vaccinated. And that's what sort of was the going thought. And that was totally wrong, by the way. What these studies revealed is problems in the immunization delivery system. And so my team, working with others, developed the simplest model in the world. But we've used this model for several decades. I actually think this type of model could be useful for many other high prevalence diseases. And it simply looks at what are the barriers to vaccination from the patient perspective, from the provider perspective, and from the system perspective. And we meticulously, one by one, try to figure out what are the barriers and can we do anything about them. So from the patient perspective, some patients don't have access to primary care. Some vaccines, like the flu vaccine, needs an extra visit frequently. There's lack of knowledge about the vaccine. There's fear of the vaccine. There were cost barriers. There's less now. And certainly hesitancy is now on the rise. But there were some hesitancy problems back then, and there certainly is now. But the real problem we found was at the provider and system level. Providers were giving weak recommendations, not because purposefully, but they were just giving weak recommendations about vaccines. Providers didn't have a reminder recall system to bring people back in. Providers were missing opportunities, and I'll talk about these. Providers didn't have the abilities back then to do practice improvement or quality improvement to try to improve their rates. And there were system problems. There were some shortages, especially for flu vaccine, although shortages have gone away for the most part. Systems weren't doing reminder recall. There were financing problems that I'm not going to talk about, but it was a real big problem in the 80s. Scattering of care, we all know about that many patients, particularly high-risk patients, you know, their care isn't concentrated as well as it could be. And school laws is sort of a whole other topic, but school laws covered very few vaccines. So the general strategy that my group has used to try to figure out how to raise vaccination rates is first to study barriers, then to study individual interventions, then to study bundles of interventions if the individual interventions had a sort of a small effect, and then to try to figure out how to scale it up and disseminate it. And I actually think this very simple process might be useful for other diseases such as obesity or mental health problems or asthma. So I'm going to go through three important barriers to vaccinations and what we could do about it. One barrier that it kind of pops up among patient, provider, and system is no reminder recall. Remember, some patients need extra visits, they don't know about the vaccines, providers weren't doing reminder recall, and systems weren't doing it. So what is patient reminder recall? You can recall or remind patients to come in for vaccines using a number of different modalities, right? Letters, postcards, telephone, autodialer, texts, emails, apps, there's different ways to do it. You can vary the intensity, you can vary the frequency, you can combine it with outreach. You can send reminders to parents or for adolescent vaccines to adolescents. Where could the reminders come from? It could come from practices or HMOs or registries, and we'll talk about these. But to do reminder recall, you need a few simple things. You need a registry. You need to figure out who your patients are and who needs to be reminded and recalled. You need some sort of patient contact, like a telephone number or mail. And you need algorithms to figure out who needs a vaccine. And you need some resources. So it's a little bit more complicated than you think. Well, early on, we did a study. This is actually a Cochrane review a long time ago. Wow. 16 years ago, looking at the effectiveness of reminder recall in improving immunization rates, where we looked at child influenza vaccines, child preschool vaccines, and adult vaccines. And this is a systematic review of the literature for 32 studies for what's the odds of being up to date for vaccines among patients that got reminded versus patients who didn't get reminded. And these were all randomized clinical trial studies. And generally the odds ratios were pretty high, like 2 to 3, suggesting that it's a pretty effective intervention if it's used. And this simple slide summarizes about 50 studies about reminder recall for preschool kids and for flu vaccines. The impact is largest if the baseline rates are low. You don't get an enormous bump with reminder recall. You get about 2 to 10 percentage points. The impact is actually lower among low-income populations. Unfortunately, they need it the most, but they're harder to reach, they're harder to get back in. Their impact is higher if combined with outreach, and I'll show you some data about this. The costs vary. It turns out mail might work better than telephone, but mail is much more expensive than telephone. And the point in red I want to put in, because this is a real sort of, part of me wears a public health hat, part of me wears a pediatric hat. And if you have a very small patient population and you raise rates by 20%, that's great for that small population, but at the whole country level, it may not be that great. If you have an entire country and you could scale up an intervention, even if you have an intervention that only has a small effect, if it's disseminated, scaled up to the whole country, that could have a large public health impact. Does that make some sense? Okay. The problem here about reminder recall is that the proportion of practices using reminder recall is very low. Very few practices use reminder recall for immunizations. And the reasons are that it costs some money, there's data problems, there's algorithm problems, even something as simple as immunizations. So our team asked two questions, and now I'm going to HPV vaccine, or actually adolescent vaccinations. If practices can't do reminder recall, can centralized reminder recall work for HPV vaccine? Since it works for child vaccines and since so few practices use it. And then if you add outreach, does it work better? So let's talk about the first question. We did a randomized clinical trial to test centralized reminder recall for adolescent vaccinations, including HPV vaccine. We did this in a very large Medicaid managed care HMO. It was comparable to LA Care. We took 4,000 adolescents in 37 practices and did a three-arm randomized clinical trial where we literally randomized kids within practices to getting a phone reminder, getting mailed reminders, or not getting anything different than the practice already does, and did multiple calls. And the outcomes were vaccination rates and well child care visit rates and costs, because we want to see whether just reminding them about immunizations brings them in more for well child care visits. And what we found with the centralized reminder recall is a modest impact. Mailed reminders and phone reminders, 6%, 3% impact. But remember what I just said about the public health impact, if you could scale this up. We also found similar impact on improving well child care visit rates. And the costs were $18 per year for mail, and it was about $1.30 per member per month, if you think about it from a managed care type of a population medicine hat. And for those interested, the number needed to treat was actually not that high for a very simple public health intervention. So it's kind of promising to use centralized reminder recall if it could be scaled up, although it doesn't blow you away in terms of the impact. So who can do centralized reminder recall? Well, HMOs, just like the study that I just showed, can do it, and Kaiser does it. Health systems or ACOs like UCLA Health could do reminder recalls. And statewide or regional immunization registries could do reminder recalls. So all states have registries. In some states, registries are, vaccination data are required to be fed into registries. They're very large systems that could potentially do reminder recall. So we actually have two R01 studies ongoing. And I don't know if Margot Wilk is here, but she's the coordinator for these two R01 studies. We're collaborating with Denver and Colorado, and we're testing the question about whether an entire state immunization registry can improve vaccination rates by doing reminder recall for HPV vaccine and for influenza vaccine. Because remember, those rates are low. And these are randomized clinical trials across New York State and Colorado. We're doing the same method that I just showed you with the other studies. We're randomizing patients within practices to getting 0, 1, 2, or 3 reminders. There's a large sample size, and we'll measure the impact on rates and costs. And I'm excited about this study because even though it's not going to, you know, sort of markedly elevate immunization rates, if we can do it and if the costs are low, this is something that can be scaled up for the whole country. So what about adding outreach? Does that work better? There's many ways to do outreach. So we did a randomized clinical trial to add outreach to reminder recall for adolescent immunizations, where we worked with 9 enormous practices. This is in Rochester, which covered 60% of all adolescents in the city. These are very large practices. We randomized 6,700 adolescents to getting an intervention versus standard of care. We randomized within practices again. And the intervention was reminder recall plus outreach. And we measured vaccination rates and well child care visit rates and costs. So what do I mean by outreach? We had outreach, we had community workers situated in these large practices. They had very large caseloads, like 800 kids. And they tracked immunization rates. They sent reminder recall. And the highest risk kids, they actually did a home visit, but that wasn't a big part of the outreach. Most of it was just doing, sort of trying to sort of bring them in to the practice for immunizations. So we kind of increased the intervention depending on the need. And the impact was actually very large. You can see the up-to-date rates for all vaccine for intervention versus control groups, a big improvement. And this is all kids who are poor. In the 7th poorest city in the United States, this is the only study I've ever seen where an intervention brought more kids in for, was able to demonstrate that we could bring more kids in for well child visit rates, adolescent kids who were very high risk adolescents. So we overall found a 12 to 16 percentage point improvement in all practices. The cost was higher though, $3.55 per patient per month. The number needed to treat was only 9. So the intervention, if you add outreach to reminder recall, it's effective, but it's somewhat costly. So kind of a summary of reminder recall is that reminder recall has an important role. It can raise immunization rates, sort of a small amount. Adding outreach doubles the impact, at least, but at a higher cost. Centralized reminders might be promising. And I've been using this term more and more across the country. There's no more home runs in the immunization delivery world. There's only singles. There's not going to be a magic formula to sort of bump up immunization rates super high. So let's go to modifiable barrier number 2. And I'm only going to do this and then one other barrier. Missed opportunities, which many people have heard about. So what's a missed opportunity? People talk about missed opportunities in sports. You know, you missed an opportunity for a goal or whatever. Well, a missed opportunity for a vaccination is a healthcare visit at which a patient is actually eligible for a vaccine but doesn't get it. So a brief summary of missed opportunities and the relevance. And I'm going to focus on HPV vaccine, although we've done similar studies for flu. Most pediatricians and family physicians vaccinate only during well child visits, not so much during sick or chronic illness visits. Missed opportunities actually occurred both during sick visits and well child care visits. They're never intentional. I've never met a physician that said, I'm going to miss some opportunities today. You know, it just doesn't happen. They're never intentional. But reducing missed opportunities is really hard. And there's been studies in the childhood literature that it's difficult to do. But look at this data. This is national data published in 2 different MMWRs. If all simultaneous missed opportunities, which means an opportunity when a kid was do an HPV vaccine, got another vaccine, but didn't get the HPV vaccine. If they were all eliminated, vaccination rates for HPV would be 90%, not 53%. That would translate, in my book, to 90 fewer teens getting warts, 15 fewer teens with eventual cancer. So missed opportunities represent a potentially low-hanging fruit. So how can you eliminate missed opportunities? Because again, it's nobody's fault. Well, you can use prompts. And prompts could be given by nurses, or electronic medical records can do prompts. And I know in our clinic, we have a good prompt. We did a couple of studies on prompts. So first, we did a study where we asked in 2 large national research networks, physicians to identify the most effective intervention they could do to improve HPV vaccination rates. And they chose prompts only. Then when we did a randomized clinical trial to study prompts only, we found only a small impact. Kind of the level of reminder recall, not as big as we wanted. Alex Fix at CHOP did a really neat study where he studied a bundle. Do you remember that sort of stepwise thing that we're looking at barriers, individual interventions, and then bundles? He studied a bundle of provider education, how do you communicate, EMR prompts and then performance feedback back to providers. And the feedback was about your missed opportunities. And he found a much bigger bump in the HPV vaccination rates. So lessons from these two studies are provider prompts are important, but we providers often ignore prompts, and prompts by itself are not enough. Prompts and performance feedback might work even better. And the key is to address provider barriers as well as parent hesitancy, which I'm not going to talk about today, and probably a bundle, multiple interventions. And I'm just going to show one slide. I've become a real fan of quality improvement-based research. This is a study we've done at 7 large practices across the country where we combined prompts plus office changes, and the office changes were nurse prompts plus performance feedback in the QI sense. And we were able to bump HPV vaccination rates at the practice's patient level by 13 percentage points, which is higher than I've seen other immunization interventions be able to do. And we're testing this now in 75 practices across the country. And we're about to launch a new R01 to start in 2017 with 60 practices in the PROS network, the American Academy of Pediatrics PROS network, which is where we'll first test the impact of individual interventions, which is prompts, performance feedback, and then training providers in how you communicate about HPV with patients quickly, within like 20 seconds. Then we'll test the bundle, and then we'll go away and test whether the improvements are maintained. But we're gonna have to wait several years to see whether this works. So in the last few minutes, just a few points about scattering of care, which is the third modifiable barrier. And this shows up in multiple places, patient barriers as well as system barriers. So as I mentioned, the high vaccination rates for other vaccines other than HPV and flu are due to primary care. But we're having trouble with flu vaccine and HPV vaccine. So another approach is to vaccinate in the medical home plus potentially to vaccinate outside of the medical home. This is controversial, but many of us are very frustrated that we can't raise vaccination rates by doing a traditional medical approach. Well, if you look at settings outside of the medical home, where would you go? You could go to other medical sites like EDs or hospitals or specialty clinics, and those have been studied. It turns out they don't see that many kids at the population level. We live there, but they don't. But most kids aren't hospitalized or seen in the ED. Oops. Or you could go to non-medical sites, schools, churches, pharmacies. Pharmacies is tough for kids. So the most likely are probably schools. So what about school-located vaccinations, which are sort of, there's a couple ways to do it. One way to do it is to bring in a vaccine clinic to the school, almost like a mobile clinic. Well, I don't remember this, but some people may remember the polio vaccination campaigns, which were done in school. In Australia, it turns out, most kids are vaccinated in school. But in the United States, it's challenging to vaccinate in school because you need parental consent. You need to order, give vaccines. How do you walk kids to clinic? There's all this practical stuff. And how do you bill? How do you measure post-vaccination stuff like, or how do you actually do post-vaccination tasks like get the data into a registry? So we did a research question. Can this even be done for influenza vaccine? And we're doing it now for HPV. And will it raise rates? So I want to present to you just in a minute a study that we just finished called School-Located Influenza Vaccinations. We did a randomized clinical trial to try to measure whether doing a temporary school flu clinic raises vaccination rates. And in 2014-2015, for the flu vaccination season, we took most of upstate New York County, one urban district and 6 suburban districts. We took 22 pairs of schools and randomized the schools into getting a clinic versus not having a clinic. And we did web-based consent and backpack flyers. And the impact was actually relatively large. Remember, I'm trying to set expectations low. Thank you. So the impact was relatively large. 8 percentage point improvement in flu vaccination rates in suburban schools and 5 percentage points in urban schools, which is a pretty large impact of the flu vaccine clinics at the public health level. Well, I'd say maybe moderate impact if it could be scaled up. Well, that's flu vaccine. What about HPV vaccinations? And again, as I mentioned, in Australia, Australia vaccinates most adolescents in school, But everything seems much more complicated in our country than in some other countries. In the US, for adolescents, there's two possible models. One is to do what I was just showing you for flu vaccine, which is sort of bring in a flu clinic. And what we did is we used the local school health, the public health department to sort of just do a school clinic. The other way to do this is to work with school-based health clinics. So, you know, these are those clinics that already exist in many urban, large urban high schools and sometimes middle schools. Excuse me. This might be promising, but the problem, as I think about this from the national level, is that there's only 2,000 school-based health clinics. So at the huge level, this can only vaccinate a small number of adolescents, if you think about it at the US level. On the other hand, in the inner city, where there are school-based health clinics, these are very high-risk kids. They have higher risk of getting HPV disease. They have poorer access to care. So can it work? I want to give a shout out to Megha Shah, who's a pediatric fellow who's been working with me. And she's doing heroic work working with two school-based health clinics. One is Hollywood High School, a school-based health clinic, and the other is Roosevelt High School. She's done two studies. The first was a qualitative study to look at the feasibility of giving HPV vaccine in a school-based health clinic. And the second is to study a bundle. Remember, this bundle keeps coming up. And the bundle in this case was a bunch of little, what seems like little things, but they're not little. They're really hard to do. Send the VIS form, which is the vaccine information statement forms that all parents need to get before a vaccine. Send them in at the beginning of school to all parents. At every visit, when a kid comes in for an acute illness or for a sexually transmitted disease or a mental health problem, at every visit at a school-based health center, check whether they need an HPV vaccine, check the registry, give the vaccine. So she's working to try to change the workflow to give the vaccine, and then give performance feedback to the providers about their missed opportunities. We have some really exciting preliminary results where if the baseline missed opportunity rate is around 85%, it actually may be higher. We found, so down is good in this slide, so missed opportunity rates have been going down based on her study. So we'll have to see, the study's has just gotten going a few months ago, but I think we're gonna be able to really reduce missed opportunities and raise vaccination rates. So the fourth really important barrier, which is why maybe many of you are here, I don't know, is provider communication. So this is a whole different Grand Rounds. I have a Grand Rounds on provider communication. I can come back and give it at some point, but it's so important and so complicated. I have videos to show how we tend to communicate poorly, how we tend to communicate well, but I just don't have time to go into it, but I don't want to minimize it. I did know, by the way, that when I moved from Rochester to LA that I was coming to the hotbed of vaccine hesitancy and craziness, and it really exists. You know, but if you leave LA, it's not this way. Other than Seattle and Boulder, Colorado, and a couple of other places, it's not this way. But there's something about the HPV vaccine that makes provider communication super, super important. So this is worth really thinking about for people who give HPV vaccine. So just to let you know, there are new vaccines and vaccine policy changes on the horizon. And I just want to show you again that schema for how our country kind of walks through, I think, very logical and systematic and research-based steps to evaluate new vaccines or new guidelines. So in a month, ACIP will be considering a two-dose HPV vaccine schedule, and I predict we'll vote to go with a two-dose vaccine schedule because of stuff that Barbara Mashiki talked about a few months ago, that two doses appear very efficacious and immunity is very good. There'll be some changes in sometime with the shingles vaccine. I kind of alluded to this. There's been a lot of studies about RSV vaccine with some disasters decades ago, as the ID people know about. But I have a feeling within a couple of years, there'll be a vote about an RSV vaccine for pregnant women. I just heard last week at a meeting in Atlanta that several Two Zika virus vaccines, I believe, are in phase three trials right now, and ACIP will be considering those. I've been hearing about some really exciting basic science advances on flu vaccines. So there may be new flu vaccines coming on the market. And as I mentioned during the early part of my talk, I think maybe in 4 or 5, 6 years, we will be seeing a norovirus vaccine. So just in summary and some lessons back to the case, which is us, vaccination rates are very high, except for a few vaccines, influenza vaccine and HPV vaccine. Vaccination policy depends on a series of studies. It's one of those wonderful areas where research mixes with public health and implementation. Acute respiratory illnesses, influenza is preventable. It's not a perfect vaccine, but it's moderately effective. RSV will be preventable or somewhat preventable in the future. And there's vaccines for paraflu and HMPV. For gastroenteritis, rotavirus is quite preventable. Norovirus is next. HPV is completely preventable. We just have to figure out how to do it. There's 4 steps to raise vaccination rates, but there are no home runs, only singles. And I think we have to do them all. Reminder, recall, figure out how to lower missed opportunities. Figure out how to balance using other sites for care and do provider communication. Multiple bundled interventions probably work better than single interventions. And this patient-provider system paradigm has been useful for immunizations, and it might be useful for other preventable diseases or for other big public health conditions. So I want to thank an awful lot of people. I'm not going to go through everybody, but the immunization teams in Rochester and UCLA, many collaborators across the country, and a lot of primary care practices who've been willing to collaborate with my crazy studies. And I'm just going to leave this, in case there's questions and discussions, I'm going to leave the summary and lessons on the screen, and I thank you very much for your attention.